just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. Your name is power. Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy, and Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus.
Thank you. Meryl is up here, and she's been doing a prayer walk. And what's that about, Meryl?
The prayer walk, as you know, we're praying for a different street each week, so each month. So we're doing Houston Street this month, and we walk around and we put a pamphlet in each letterbox to say that we're praying for them. And we have a prayer phone, so if they have any prayer requests, they can ring that prayer phone and let us know. And we've had a couple of people respond with prayer requests, so that's really good. So it's just to let them know that we care about them and that we're praying over them and for them.
So Meryl, tell me, you've got a bit of a passion in relation to prayer, but let's go back a bit. Did you always pray? I mean, even as a child, what's your background there?
Well, I was an O'Connor, so I grew up as a Catholic, and it was encouraged to pray to Mary or the saints or somebody else. But I always felt as a child to go straight to the top and pray to Jesus. And so I've always had a relationship with Jesus and spoke to him and talked to him through my childhood, I can remember. Yeah.
Okay. So at some point this became very real. It became more than just doing something like that. So what was the catalyst? What sort of changed where you found prayer being so vital?
Well, I have found through my life to pray specifically to God. It's a bit like when he was saying to put more water on the altar with Baal, you know, when that the God who answers by fire be God. So when I pray, I need something, I don't just say, oh Lord, I need something. I pray, I want it to look like this, and I pray out the desires of my heart, basically. And one example of that was I absolutely needed a new job. So I stood in the middle of my lounge room and I said, okay, Lord, this is what I want as a job. And I just prayed out the desires of my heart and gave him a list of things that I'd like my job to be. And the next day I was in the tea room and I sat down, and right next to me was a little note on the notice board with an expression of interest in a new team that was starting at the hospital. And it turned out to be the best job that you could ever hope for in nursing. It was wonderful, and it was exactly what I had prayed for.
Wow.
So God has done that so many times through my life, fulfilled each little requirement of my prayer. So through my life, I've just found that he does answer prayer. It might take a while, like with my husband. 30 years later, I got a husband, but he was the best husband that you could get.
So it's worth the wait, apparently. That's, you know, when you pray, you don't see it straight away. It's actually worth the wait.
Yeah.
So that sounds like now. What about now? You've seen those things happen down through. So what about today? What about this year?
Well, now I absolutely know that he hears my prayer. In Daniel, it talks about from the moment you're determined in your heart for these things to happen, he sent response to that, what Daniel prayed. And that's how I feel, that even before I know I need these things, he's sending a response to my prayer. So I can pray big, I can pray broad, I can pray for the desires of my heart, because I have Jesus in me, so my desires are his desires. And so I just know that he, even though, like as we've seen, that it might tarry, it might not come straight away, wait for it, because it will happen. Yeah.
Thanks, Meryl. Let's give her a hand. Okay. So Matt's going to bounce off that and share something. Thank you, Matt. That mic there for you. Okay.
Good morning, everyone. How are we?
Good morning.
Prayer, the how and the why. Now, there's a couple of things I want to just mention just quickly before we go. Firstly, I did not collaborate with anyone today. So I didn't talk to Marie about the songs that she was singing. I didn't talk to Meryl about what she was talking about. And I definitely did not talk to Peter about his communion message. So let me put that straight there, right here and now, okay? Keep that in mind. It may even blow your mind. The other thing I wanted to point out is that the last time I heard a sermon on prayer, it was actually about 7 sermons in a series labeled the Lord's Prayer. So give me a chance here. I'm going to try to condense this right down for you. So I remember as a teenager growing up, I used to referee basketball. And I was doing the Christian comp, and the way they used to run it is instead of paying you per game, they'd pay you at the end of the year for however many games, and you got a check. Now imagine a 13-year-old kid doing 3 or 4 games a week over the space of about 20 weeks and getting $20 a game. Can you imagine how big that check was? Woohoo! So anyway, being the good Christian boy I was, one of the first things I bought was a Bible. It was a teen study Bible. And on it, it had a page, and I remember it vividly. And it used to have on these study pages a bit of a joke sort of thing. And it said, "What is prayer? Prayer is talking to the ceiling and wondering whether anyone's actually listening." That's kind of amusing. But you know what? At times, that actually resounded with me. I remember at times thinking, like, are you even listening? Do you hear what I'm saying? What am I that you're mindful of me? The definition that we get out of a dictionary for prayer is an act of communication by humans with the sacred or holy, namely God. In simple terms, it's talking to God, that is, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Prayer is a universal thing. Everyone in the entire world prays at some point in their life. Don't believe me? Walk through any schoolyard just before an exam. But sometimes it really feels awkward. We don't know the words to say. We haven't got one of those books on hand. Liturgy is a great thing, but I think it's caused us a lot of stumbling stones. But it shouldn't. It's natural to talk to your Father, and your Father wants to talk to you. Prayer is our way of reconnecting with God. Back in the beginning, before we turned to sin, God would walk with us in the garden, side by side, talking, sharing fellowship. In Genesis 3:8, just after the man and woman had partaken of the fruit, we read, "Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking through the garden in the cool of the day." Pause. The cool of the day. We seem to reflect that as either early morning or late in the evening. But if you actually look at the Hebrew text, that word that they use for cool of the day is a cool breeze. The same word that we use for the Spirit of the Lord. So he was there, and all parts of him were there, communing in perfect communion with man. And they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called out to the man, "Where are you?" Dwell on that for a second. God is omniscient. He knows everything. He knew exactly where they were. He wasn't saying, "Where are you?" He was saying, "Why have you separated yourself from me? Come back. Come back to me." You see, the next 40 books is God continually offering man a chance. Here's an olive branch. Just take it. And man, in all their wisdom, and I'll use that term, man as all humans, man and woman, just throw it back in his face. I'm not interested. My way, it's my way. I know what's best. Our sin and the love of it, the things of the flesh, separated us from God. As Paul said to the Colossians, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior. God's not the one that said, go away. We were. We deserved nothing more than to be destroyed. We should have been obliterated from the face of the earth, from the universe, gone, nothing like that. Romans 5, 8-11. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Since we've now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only this, so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. It's through his death that we, that is peoples from every nation and tribe and culture around the whole entire world, can now be reconnected with God and come to him freely. We can freely come to the Father. As Paul continues in Colossians, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. In Ephesians he writes, for he himself is our peace, who has made the two groups one and destroyed the barrier. That is, there's no Jew, there's no Gentile, we're all one people under God. The dividing war of hostility, by setting aside in his flesh the law with its commands and regulations. His purpose was to create in himself one new humanity out of the two, thus making peace, and in one body to reconcile both of them to God through the cross, by which he put to death their hostility. He came and preached peace to you who were far away, and he preached peace to those who were near, the Prince of Peace, obviously worthy of our praise. For through him, we both have access to the Father by one Spirit. He died for us so we can be reconciled. And nothing can ever separate us again. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present or the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen. Isn't that great? Doesn't matter what we've done, where we've been, who we are, we can now be reconnected with God. But, and if there's anything in this whole talk that you take away, make sure it is this. Communication is the key to any relationship. Communication is the key to any relationship. If you ain't talking, there's no relationship there. I guarantee you, whenever there's a fight in any sort of family, it's because of a breakdown in communication. If there's an argument at work, if things aren't going the way they planned, it's because of a breakdown in communication. 17 years in the army, and after every single activity, we'd have a conference and we'd say, right, what were the good things, what were the bad things, what needs to be improved? And every time, every single time, I didn't hear about that. We weren't communicating good enough. We need to improve our communication. Aaron and I met in the year 2000 at this little thing called the Sydney Paralympic Games. We were 16 at the time, and I was a Air Force cadet, she was a Naval cadet, and we were typical teenagers, and it was teenager love. And then we separated, went our own ways, but at the end of that, we all gave our numbers out on a piece of paper so we could all keep in contact and whatnot. You know, it was a great time, meet new friends and all that sort of stuff. Because we're both on Optus, there used to be something called free talk time, and she called me up and we started talking. And we talked and we talked and we talked and we talked. And we fell asleep talking and we woke up talking, we talked. There's not much that I don't know about that lady, and there's not much that she doesn't know about me. And we have a strong bond and relationship because of that. But in the times that we've found things difficult, and we're both human, and I've done some horrible stuff, and I'm sure there's stuff that she's done to me, but when these things happen, it was because we stopped talking. She can't read my mind. She doesn't know what I'm thinking. I can't read hers. I don't know what she's thinking. I may think that I think they know, and she may think that I think that I think they know, but they don't. And the only way you really know is to speak it out. We, the church, are preparing ourselves for the greatest marriage festival ever. In fact, you know how I said 40 books was all about God reaching out to us and saying, hey, take this, take this? The next 20-odd is us going, okay, let's do this. And the last one, one of the last parts of it, Revelation 19, let us rejoice and be glad and give him glory, for the wedding of the Lamb has come and his bride has made herself ready. So people, get ready, Jesus is coming. So if God knows what's in my heart, and he knows my desires, he knows what I want, why pray? You see, the thing is that prayer is a little bit like the Sabbath and worship. He don't need your pitiful petitions. He doesn't need your cries for help. He knows all that already. Prayer is not for him, it's for you. Psychologists have done a lot of study in this. And the mind is a fascinating thing. Females, believe it or not, can not only think and do multiple things, they can do them all at the same time. Guys have a bit more trouble with that, but women can't read maps. Generally speaking. So the way the male mind works is usually it's more logical and we can think things out, and we know that even though we're looking and we're going that way on a map, that would be your left, my right. That would be your right, my left. But because I'm going down, it's the opposite. And males can naturally work that out and just think of it. Women have a bit more trouble. But women, as I said, generally speaking, but in the same token, women can be sitting there talking, doing maths equations, driving a car, and typing out an essay over here, all at the same time. And guys are still trying to work out what we're talking about. But the psychologists have realised that our mind is that complex that quite often we start to jumble things up inside there. And when we have problems with memory loss and focusing on certain things that are coming up and that kind of thing, the best way to get clarification and realign everything is to talk out loud. Because your brain, when you're talking, can only move as fast as your lips. So when I'm confused about something and I need clarification, just the act of me talking to God and saying, God, I don't know where I'm going. What am I doing? Why is this happening? Should I do this? If I do this, blah, 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 blah. If I do this, blah, 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 blah. And now it's coming out in succinct. Take that a step further. Neuroscientists have been doing staying brain activity when people are praying. And as much as you're slowing everything down and speaking it out, the brain activity actually increases. So you're now overactivating different parts of the brain that weren't working before. And that's all through prayer, not just talking, prayer. One step further, because we are a Pentecostal church, when you speak in tongues, it's not just the frontal part of the brain, the cognitive and linguistic associated parts. It actually starts to activate other parts of the brain, parts that are connected with physical healing and emotional development. Kind of interesting, isn't it? So all this prayer and stuff like that, it's meant for us. It's to build us up. So I guess the question is then, now that we know why we should pray, how? Now, some of you have heard this story before. Hopefully I do a good telling of it. It's about a little girl. I'm going to name her Lily Kitten Be Wanton. And one day she was at the markets with her parents, and there was a stall of animals there, and there was these cute little kittens, and, oh, mommy, mommy, daddy, can I please have a kitten, please? And dad, being a bit of a skeptic and whatnot, went, I'll tell you what, you believe in Jesus, you pray to him, and when he gives you a kitten, you can keep it. What a horrible dad. So she goes home, and that afternoon she gets outside and she sits there on the lawn. She goes, dear Jesus, I really want a kitten. No kitten. And she did this day in, day out, day in, day out, and just kept doing it. She persevered. Not for 30 years, but she did it. Enter our next character into the story. I'm just going to call her Mrs. Kravitz, who just so happened to have a new kitten. And she opened the door to go get the mail, and being a little bit older in age, the cat, out the door, up the nearest tree. Now, the thing with cats is, they're really good at climbing up, not so good at coming down. So she calls up the fireman, and fireman Sam comes out with his mates, and he starts getting the ladder and everything out. And the new kid, Billy, goes, I can reach that branch there. I'll grab that branch and I'll pull it down and I'll get the kitten. So he climbs up there, grabs the branch. Quick, someone grab that. Twing! Kitty went flying. Two houses over. And there's Lily in the backyard. Dear Jesus, can I please have a... Thank you. Dad, 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 dad! God answers our prayers. Sometimes it's straight away, sometimes it takes a long time, but he always answers them. Unfortunately, we don't always get the answer that we want. There's a movie, it's called Bruce Almighty. It's a comedy, and it's not very theologically accurate, but it's a comedy and it's quite amusing. And in this, Bruce has all the answers. We've all met that guy. Why would God do that? If I was God, I know better. God can't exist because this is how it should be. Well, Bruce was that guy. And one day he ran into God. And God said, I'm going on a vacation. Here's the keys. You have complete control. Enjoy. And he stepped back and let him be God. He gave him all of his powers. And he's sitting there one night trying to think about what he was going to do the next day. And all these voices start going, need something to write it down. There's all these post-it notes everywhere. He goes, okay, well, that didn't work. All right, I know what. He'll create his own email system. And up comes the email system. Bing! You have 1.5 million new prayer requests. Okay, I'll start answering some of those. Now, how's that look? Bing! You have 3.5 new prayer requests. So he goes, all right. Yes to all. Done. Now everyone's happy. The next day, the news broadcaster is going, you would never believe it. Every single team in the whole of sports this weekend just won. All these people in the lottery. We won the jackpot, the major jackpot. 17 cents? Can you imagine the devastation that would have fallen upon our world if everyone who was fighting in World War II had have had their answer, had had their prayers answered when they said, I just want to win. Sometimes his answer is going to be a no. But reflecting on World War II, there was this thing called the Holocaust. And there was a lady who survived it, Corrie Ten Boom. Amazing story, you should look it up one day. But she said that when a train is going through a tunnel and it gets dark, you don't throw away your ticket and jump off, because that's certain to end in doom. Instead, you sit back, you relax, and you trust the engineer, the train driver. When you're racing cars, you tune them. Before and after each race, you make minor alterations and change it. Change the different settings in the tyres, in the steering, the suspension, the engine, the throttle, all this sort of stuff. But it's more important to make sure that it's consistent and works well every time. I want to be able to know that if I turn it this much, it's going to turn that much. Because that's better than going super fast. Because I go super fast and it's not going to turn while I'm expecting it to, it's going to crash. It's the same thing with prayer. There's no secret equation to it. God is not a genie in a bottle. You don't rub him a particular way and you get three wishes. You just need to be consistent. Remember, prayer is our connection to God. We had that relationship, and he wants to reunite us in that relationship with him. What was it that was said in communion? It's just spending time with him. Just spending time with him. Jesus told us in Matthew 6:6, so this is just before the Lord's Prayer, and he's just finished telling us how we don't need to stand on the streets and with our hands up and make a big song and dance about our prayers. He's saying, when you pray, go into your room, close the door and pray to your Father who is unseen. And then your Father who sees what he's done in secret will reward you. Turn off the phone. Turn off the TV. Go somewhere peaceful and quiet. It may be driving to work. It may be next to your bed before you go to sleep at night. Maybe it's going for a walk in the morning. Maybe it's just driving out of town somewhere in the middle of the bush and just listening to his creation. But make that time, separate yourself, and do it regularly. If possible, go there at least once a day and just spend some time with Dad. You know, when I was the strongest in my prayer life, it was when I was a teenager. I guess back then I didn't have all the hang-ups I have now as an adult. I didn't have people sleeping in the bed next to me. I wasn't worried about what other people thought. It was just me and him. And I would sit there and I'll talk. I'll tell him about things that happened during the day. He knew all that. But I'll talk to him about it. And I'll sit there in quiet contemplation and listen. And you can believe it or you cannot believe it. That's up to you. But I honestly heard him talking back. And things that I was struggling with, I'd get contemplation and I would understand. And I knew what I had to do. Do I always do it? No. But I knew. Because when we pray, we align ourselves up with him. As we talk these things out, the things that our mind can say, oh, don't worry about that, we then suddenly realize, hang on, we need to deal with that. And we line up with him. So Lord, teach us to pray. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we also forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. And depending on what text you're reading, for thine is the power and the glory for now and forever. Amen. It's a very simple prayer. But for those who don't normally pray, I'm going to suggest a slightly different way of doing it. Thank you. When we look around us and see all the things that we actually do have, we talk about poverty and doing it hard. You're not in the Middle Ages. You're not scraping the dirt trying to find witchetty grubs to eat. You have access to all these things. As much as man's put that in place, it's only because of God allowing man to do it. If we be thankful and we show gratitude, it automatically puts our hearts in the right place to move forward. Next, sorry. Remember, the only thing that stops us from approaching God is us. By addressing our own faults and our own limitations, we can begin to repent. That is, truly be sorrowful and start changing the way we are. Yes, we need the Holy Spirit indwelling in us to change, but it's how you're going to react to the Holy Spirit's prompting. This aligns us up with God's will. And remember what Jesus said? Seek first the kingdom of God, and then everything else will be added unto you. It's pretty simple. If my will aligns up with God's will, because God's will be done, it's going to happen. And finally, please. Please. There is nothing too big. There is nothing too small. There is nothing too important. There's nothing too insignificant to bring to your Father. Amen. You might be angry with the person who cut you off. So we forgive them. And we just ask, hey, Lord, teach them how dangerous it was to cut me off. They could have caused an accident. Thank you that he didn't cause an accident. If any of you were asked by a child for a fish, would you give him a snake? That's how Jesus put it. So why would your Father give you one? praying is a pillar of our faith, and it should be done unceasingly, no matter what. There's been times in my life where I've wanted prayer and I've wanted answers to prayer, and I haven't got what I wanted. And it hurts. But there's so many times when I look back at what I wanted and what I thought was best and realise that, hey, his ideas were a bit better. Next time you go and pray, instead of making it liturgical and following a script and doing all this sort of stuff, just talk. When you came in this morning, how many of you, as you walked in the door, said, "Can I have, I want, please do," and that came a list of demands? I'll put it to you, none. So if that's how we greet each other, why don't we greet God the same way? What did he say to his disciples? "Slaves don't know a master's business, but you know mine. You're no longer my slaves. Indeed, I call you a friend." If you've never prayed before, or you wish to be joined in prayer, then please feel free to come to the front. Myself, Pastor Dave, Pastor John would love to pray with you. Otherwise, please enjoy some fellowship. That's all part of that communion. But just remember, communion is the key to every relationship. And all you got to do is pick up the phone once in a while. He's only ever a prayer away. So, Father, as we go away from this, I ask that you'll touch our hearts and you'll open our minds. Help us as we go forward to put into practice these things that I've spoken about. Help us to spend 5 minutes a day, 10 minutes a day, half an hour a day, just time, quality time with you and you alone. In your name we pray. Amen.
I need you more. More than yesterday, I need you, Lord. More than words can say, I need you more than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
Sing with me. air I breathe, more than the air I breathe, the song I sing,
more than the song I sing, more than the next heartbeat.
Need you more than anything.
More than anything, Lord, as time goes by, I'll be by your side. 'Cause I never wanna go back to my old life. I need you more than yesterday.
I need you more.
Words can say,
I need you more
than ever before. I need you, Lord. I need you, Lord.
Right here in your presence is where I. Now my broken heart has finally found a home, and I'll never be alone. I need you more.
I need you.